With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
This is your captain speaking. We've got clear runway and the weather's fine, but we're just going to circle up here a while and get lucky. No, nothing like that. It's just these cash prizes add up quick. So I suggest you sit back, keep your tray table upright, and start getting lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Lucky Land Casino, asking people, what's the weirdest place you've gotten lucky?
Lucky? In line at the deli, I guess?
Aha, in my dentist's office. More than once, actually.
Do I have to say?
Yes, you do.
In the car, before my kids' PTA meeting.
Really?
Yes.
Excuse me, what's the weirdest place you've gotten lucky?
I never win and tell.
Well, there you have it. You can get lucky anywhere, playing at LuckyLandSlots.com. Play for free right now. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Tonight, go with me to Revelation chapter number 14 tonight. Revelation chapter number 14 tonight. Revelation chapter number 14. One day, this side of the church is going to cave in. There is nobody over here tonight. I tell y'all, if this side of the church ever gets mad on a Sunday at this side, I'm going to stay right here because this side's going to take out this side. Revelation chapter number 14 tonight. Revelation chapter number 14 tonight. Last Wednesday night, we started in Revelation chapter number 14. We've dealt with the world rescued by God, dealt with the formal warnings, and we dealt with the special company in heaven. Tonight, I want us to go a step further tonight. I want us to deal with the special commission that is in heaven. The special commission that is in heaven. And I've enjoyed going through the book of Revelation. It's got a few more chapters to go. And trying to figure out where we're going next. Somebody said we ought to go through the book of Daniel next. And I'm praying about that to see where we should go. I mean, we got a ways to go, don't get me wrong, but still praying about which way to go and thinking about it. But Revelation chapter number 14 tonight, we see here tonight in Revelation 14 that three angels now appear, commissioned with messages, announcements, and warnings for the earth. And go with me to verse number 6 tonight, Revelation 14 and verse number 6. When you find your place there, say amen. All right. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell where? On the earth. And to which nation? Every nation and kindred and tongue and people. So every nation's going to hear the gospel. Every kindred person's going to hear the gospel. Every person's going to hear the gospel in their own language, which will be an equivalent to Acts chapter number 2. Does everybody agree with me on that? All right. And people saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. And I'm going to have to retract a statement that I've made several times through the book of Revelation. The kid's looking at me like, oh Lord, what are you going to retract? When we go back into Revelation, we've talked about the only people that will be saved in the last days is who? The 144,000, right? But the gospel is going to go out to every man, woman, boy, and girl. Every nation is going to hear the gospel one last time before the judgment of God comes. With that being said, the Bible says that God's word will not do what? Return to him void, right? If the gospel is given out to every man, woman, boy, and girl, do you not think that God would not allow somebody to give their heart and life to him in those last times? Is that a valid question? So that if God would send the gospel, then he has to me, he wouldn't just give you the gospel without giving you the opportunity to accept the gospel. Right? Is that a valid point? Anybody got any objections to that? So it would be more than just a Jew that could be saved at that point, which would go back to the point Joanne made to me a few weeks ago. Would you like to expound on how you said that to me a few weeks ago about the 12 tribes? Correct. Correct. So that would make sense here. Brother Jim, you got something?
Now, am I understanding this 144,000? No.
That's where I'm...
Or is that an army that he's going to subject?
I'm going to be honest. I'm going to have to go back and regroup. 144,000 total will be saved. That'll be Jews. But if that's 12,000 from every tribe, then that would make sense. So, are we good?
But I understand what he's saying, because that doesn't sound like a lot of people.
Right.
We're talking about
millions of people.
Right.
Right.
And those that's passed on, that's
already in his. Right. Yeah, because the
grave's not going to give up?
Yes, the grave's already... This is after the rapture.
And then there's only 144,000
after the rapture. Correct. It doesn't. And when we talk about the 144, it doesn't sound like a lot. But when we think about it in that number, how many was it? How many billion people? 7 billion people on planet Earth today? Roughly, give or take. If we did a number, a true number, of how many people out of 7 billion people were actually Christians and going to heaven, that number would be very minimal. Does that make sense? Is that, y'all with me on that? Is the narrowest the way? Yes. So this is the only a few will accept it. Are y'all good? Are we good? Can y'all already get back in here? So now you see why I'm changing my view on that, because why would the gospel go forth if Christ wasn't asking them to accept him? That only makes sense. So I stand corrected on that, and I will admit I'm wrong on that. All right. Everybody good? So in verse number 6, the proclamation is God's last call to the earth. It is given in the great tribulation. The gospel here simply means the same thing, good news. What are we always looking for when we turn on the TV, radio, scrolling through our phone? We're always looking for good news, right? The good news is given. It's the gospel. Any person who tampers with the gospel is cursed. Go with me tonight to the book of Galatians, chapter number 1 tonight. Galatians chapter number 1 tonight. Galatians chapter number 1 tonight. Galatians chapter number 1 tonight. You know what I like? I like when the Bible messes up what we've always been taught that's not accurate. Y'all like that? Because, you know, for years... I'll go back metal on this just a little bit. For years, we've always been taught, well, the only 144,000 only be Jews. Well, it can't be if the gospel's going forth to every man, boy, girl, every nation. All right, moving on. I'll get us out of trouble, all right? Galatians chapter number 1 tonight, when you find your place there, say amen. But though we, or an angel from heaven, oh, notice this. He's referencing Revelation that hasn't been written yet. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be what? Accursed. A person that will pervert the gospel will say, you don't have to repent in order to go to heaven. A person that will say, well, if you are saved, you won't do this, this, and this, and this, and this, and that, and that, and that. And they set a bunch of rules and stipulations in place. The gospel does change a man, but the gospel is not works-based. The gospel is by grace through faith. Minus nothing, plus nothing. Right? Verse 9. As we said before, so I say now, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be what? Accursed. For do I now persuade men or who? God. Do I seek to please men? For yet if I please men, I should not be the servant of who? Christ. Tonight, when we think about this, Paul is writing to the church of Galatia, a time of heresy that has been there, has been visiting the church of Galatia. When we look at this tonight, the same problem that we have today is the same problem that Paul had in his day with people changing the gospel. Preachers preaching to please men instead of preaching to please God. People living their lives to please men instead of living their lives to please God. There are many people today that has what I call preacher religion instead of Bible salvation. What is preacher religion? As long as a preacher is alive, they will dress the way he dresses, they'll talk the way he talks, they'll do all the things that he does, but let him fall and a whole bunch of people will fall with him. Why is that? Because they're not following God, they're following a man. I can take you to a preacher that several years ago, we was in a revival meeting and a bunch of other preachers were there and we was taking up an offering. What was we taking? I don't know what we was taking up an offering for. Ain't no tellings now. They's taking up an offering and this woman gave her jewelry to the church. Okay? Took her rings off and dropped them in an offering plate. The preacher was sitting up on the platform and he seen it. Now he got up and he said, God told me that I should buy this jewelry and give it back to this woman. Okay? So we're sitting there and I was like, well, God told him to do it and he's got the money to do it. Go for it. Come to find out, the only reason he bought that jewelry back is because he was having an affair with that woman, and that was the jewelry he had given her. 2 weeks later, she come clean before the entire church about what happened. The problem with that was he had a bunch of young preachers in his church who fell by the wayside, so-called young preachers, that fell by the wayside because their leader had failed. Tonight, we as Christians, we come to church to fellowship. We come to church to hear the Word of God. We come to church to learn more about God and the gospel, right? We do not come to church to follow a man, woman, boy, or girl, but we come to follow who? God. And if we fail to follow God and we start following after men, we are not doing our jobs as a Christian. Moving on tonight. The gospel tonight. The nature of this gospel. What is the nature of the gospel tonight? Number one, it is eternal. When we think about it being eternal, John said in verse number 6, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the what? Everlasting gospel. The gospel was good enough to save now. It'll be good enough to save at the end of time. There are many people today who has heard the gospel, but they've heard it with their ears, but they've not heard it in their heart. Does that make sense tonight? A lot of people can tell you what salvation is, but they cannot tell you the experience of salvation. When I think about that tonight, I think about Miss Kim being a nurse and an EMT. I can tell you how to stitch someone up, but if you ask me to show you how to stitch someone up, I couldn't do it. Do you know why? Because I understand the concept, but I've never been in a place that I've had the experience to do it. A lot of people tonight can tell you about salvation, tell you the ins and outs of salvation, tell you the ins and outs of the church, but when you say, prove it, there's no proof there. The Bible says that we know a tree by what? The fruit it bears, right? When God saves a person, He gives us the fruit of the Spirit. And we as Christians, we should bear that fruit, right? When we think about this, the gospel is eternal. It is something that shouldn't be taken lightly. It's not something that we should change. Our methods may change, but the message of the gospel should never change. Somewhere talking to someone, and they said, my mama and daddy go to such and such Baptist church. My brother and my sister and my brother-in-law go to such and such Baptist church. And recently they have transferred churches. And when they went to transfer churches, their pastor ridiculed them for leaving the church and told them that they were not in the will of God for going to another church down the street. And because of that, people from that church has defriended my family, has defriended other, has shunned us because of that. When I thought about that tonight, that's not a church that is focused on the gospel. The gospel does not discriminate tonight. Are we good? Am I meddling? Are we good? Y'all didn't know this was in the book of Revelation, did you? The gospel does not discriminate. The gospel does not care if you're Methodist, if you're Catholic. It doesn't care if you're Mormon. It doesn't care if you're a Jehovah's Witness. If the gospel is preached, the Holy Spirit will take that gospel and show you where you stand with God. The gospel doesn't care if you're black, white, yellow, caramel color, it don't care. But what it cares about is the eternal value of the gospel. And what we do with the gospel tonight has a consequence. Every decision that you and I make tonight has a consequence. Y'all agree with that? Today I was working and I had to do inventory. Something that I am somewhat good at, but I despise. I don't like doing that, all right? I don't like counting multiple things over and over and over. Somewhere down the line, the inventory got off. Somebody made a decision that counting this piece 3 years ago and counting this same piece 2 years ago and having the same exact numbers, and when I went to go count this same exact piece and this thing hasn't sold in a million years, and I come up with another number. Somebody made a decision to truly count it maybe the first time, maybe. And then somebody said, oh, this number looks good, so I'm going to make a decision to say this number is accurate. And then when I came in and did the true count, the number was off. Does that make sense tonight? There's a lot of times when the gospel is preached that someone makes the decision to listen. Some make the decision, hey, I'm going to listen to it, but I'm not going to accept it. And then when the true count is given, their name is not found in the Lamb's Book of Life when inventory is counted. Does that make sense tonight? When we think about that, we think about death tonight. And do you know that since we've been in church, that we're one step closer to death than we was when we came into church? There is a long line of people that's died. And we're in that line. We just don't know if we're at the front of that line, the back of that line, or the middle of that line. And since we've been in church, somebody's died, and we took a step closer. When we think about salvation tonight, salvation is a free gift. The gospel is the good news that we should give to every man, woman, boy, and girl. The angel's going to preach it one last time so that someone can accept it. The gospel's not only everlasting, but the gospel's universal. He said, I want to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. I want everyone to hear it. The gospel hasn't changed since Jesus came to the earth, given the gospel. Am I right? He didn't discriminate who he gave it to. He went to the Samaria, he gave it to the woman at the well. He went to the temple, turned over the money changers' tables, cleaned house, gave the gospel, and left. He says, what happens if someone doesn't want to receive the gospel? Jesus said, shake the dust off of your feet, walk out the door and pick up your pieces and move on and go somewhere else where they will accept it. So the gospel tonight involves us telling. Secondly tonight, the gospel tonight involves conversion. Why do you say that? The Bible says, for the angel says with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to who? Him, for the hour of, notice this, not of a judgment, not of the judgment, but of his judgment. Who's that his there? Talking about God's judgment. Is come. The angel here tonight said it is not merely the day of judgment now, but the hour of judgment. C.S. Lewis said the unregenerate man always denies God glory. The saved man always gives God glory and thus comes into harmony with God's great goal both in creation and redemption to bring glory to God. C.S. Lewis had trouble saying these few words that religious people, that we praise God. His ingrained dislike for the kind of person who demands continual assurance of his own virtue, intelligence, and delightfulness did nothing to minimize this. He found the Psalms particularly troublesome with their frequent exhortations to praise the Lord. After his conversion, however, he came to see how mistaken he was in his attitude. When we say we admire a picture, for example, we mean that admiration is the correct, adequate, and appropriate response to it. And the person who fails to admire the great work of art shows his own deficiencies. Tonight, men and women who fail to recognize the great art work of God in salvation, in creation, and fail to give him praise and glory for it, are showing how corrupt they really are. A lost man will never give credit to God for creation properly, because the lost man has no intellect in his heart, is that the right word? Knowledge in his heart of how God can take something old and make something new, because he's never personally experienced it for himself. Moving on tonight, the gospel tonight not only involves conversation, the gospel tonight involves conversion, but the gospel tonight involves consecration. What do we mean? The angel cried, worship him that made what? Heaven, earth, and the sea, and the fountains of water. Worship is the highest, holiest, and happiest function of a rational, complete human being. Worship tonight is an overflowing of the heart of a Christian to God. Worship tonight is giving God the glory, honor, and praise that that God deserves. It is an act of humility to worship God, by telling him how great he is and how little you are. Worship tonight shows humility because you are telling God that because of who you are, you deserve nothing from him, but gladly receive his blessings every day. Everybody good on the gospel tonight? Secondly tonight, not only do I see the proclamation concerning their belief, I see another proclamation tonight concerning Babylon. Go with me to verse number 8 tonight. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The first mention of Babylon in the tribulation, this is the first mention of Babylon in the tribulation, but it is by no means the last. It gathers up into itself in one brief preliminary statement all that is later unfolded in chapter 17 and 18. This proclamation anticipates the complete collapse of the political, economic, and religious system of the beast. This note is sounded here in view of the warning that follows. For those alive on earth at this time will have a dire choice before them. The choice is the subject of the third proclamation. This is the second proclamation that puts things in perspective for them and helps them decide, because the triumph of Babylon will be brief. Think about this tonight. All of those are believing in Babylon to be strong, to be one of the greatest things that could ever help them. And what happens? It'll soon fail. It'll fall. This is a warning. Not only do I see the proclamation concerning Babylon tonight, but I see the proclamation concerning the beast tonight. Are we good so far? All right. Go with me to verse number 9. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of who? God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up. Notice this, not for a short period of time, but for how long? Ever and ever. And they have no rest, day nor night, who worship the beast in his image, and whoever receiveth the mark in his name. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Tonight, when we look at this, we see the doom of those who worship the beast. And we also see tonight those who receive the mark of the beast. When he gave the message tonight, when the angel gave this message, it was an urgent message. It is short, it is blunt, it is plain, and it is one with the most unique proclamations in Scripture. For it depicts the horrors of hell with a fullness of detail rare indeed in the Bible. There will be no hope for those who worship the beast, bow before his image, or receive his mark. Why? Because it's blasphemy against a true and mighty God. When we think about this tonight, there are a few things that I want to give you, three things that I want to give you. Number one, those who worship the beast will receive an undying torment from an angry God. The Bible says God's angry with the wicked how long? Every day. And his anger will be poured out. When I see this tonight, God said that he would that these would drink the wine of the wrath of God. When I think about this, he goes to verse number 11 tonight. And he says, "In the torment ascendeth up forever and ever." They think that we've received the mark of the beast, we're okay. No, you're not okay. You have just now received the mark of Satan. Not only have you received the mark of Satan, but you have received the mark of judgment, the mark of doom, the mark indicating that you are the very child of hell. When we think about it that way, it makes it serious, does it not? Indicating that you will have nothing to do with the true God, but you would rather worship the devil. And God says, "I'm done with you. You want to worship the devil? You want to receive his mark? You want to stand against me? That's fine. You can spend the rest of eternity with the devil and his angels." They have no rest day nor night. When I think about this, I think about those who say, "I'm going to go to hell and I'm going to have a big party when I get there." No, you're not. I've been told that before. I was talking to someone not too long ago, and they made this very statement to me. They said, "Listen, I know that I am a sinner and I need Christ, and one day I will accept him." I stepped back and said, "Well, if you know that much, then you should accept him now, but I can lead a horse to water and it may need the water, but I can't pull him down to make him drink it." Moving on tonight, the undying torment. But then tonight I want us to look at the destiny of those who defy the beast. When I think about that tonight, verse number 12, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." Preacher, what does it mean here, the commandments of God? Well, I couldn't help but think about Exodus chapter number 20, where he says, "Thou shalt not have any other gods before me. Thou shalt not worship any graven image," right? We think about the beast tonight. He'll be a graven image. I mean, he'll be real, but he'll be graven. When we think about this tonight, those that worship God and stay true to him will be rewarded. Go with me to verse number 13 tonight, and I'm done. "And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Write." This is John talking. Said, "Write. Blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth." Those that will not worship the beast will die. But to be absent from the body is to be what? Present with the Lord. The beast will say, "I'll kill them out." And God said, "Go ahead. But I've given unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish." What a promise. The beast says, "Go ahead. We'll make you an example of those who, to those who will not accept me. And those that will not receive the mark, we'll kill you. We'll get rid of you." They said, "That's fine. Go ahead." And God says, "And I will reward you and give you a crown." Am I right about that? I believe that's the crown of life that he gives them. Is that correct? Which is the martyr's crown. "So I'll reward you. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their" what? "Labors. And their works" do what? "Follow them." You know what Jesus said? I'm done here tonight. Do you know what Jesus said? He said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will" what? "Give you rest." Do you not think tonight that these saints that will be coming to heaven, will you not think that they have labored trying to escape the wrath of the beast? They have labored trying to tell others about the judgment to come. You think about resting tonight. We think about the sacrifices that each of us make. I brought two Bibles tonight. We think about those that, it don't take much to get me off track, does it? Squirrel. We think about those who have labored for years in the pulpit telling others about Christ. I think about those who have labored for years in their prayer closets, praying for others. For those who have carried on the work of God when everybody else quit. And when Jesus receives them, well done, thy good and faithful servant. But I believe he also will do this too. This ain't in the Bible. This is Smithology. Y'all like that sometimes, don't you? I believe he'll say, hey, there's a chair sitting over there. You've prayed long enough. You preached long enough. You worried long enough. Just sit back and rest a little while and enjoy heaven. Y'all agree with that tonight? What a great consolation that is for all of us. Think about those who have fought sickness, who have fought disease, who have fought all these things. And he said, and I'll give you rest. He didn't say give you rest on this side. And a lot of times we preach it that way, but it ain't always that way. Sometimes we have to fight our entire lives. And I believe those who endure to the end, the Bible says those that endure to the end shall be what? Saved. That's what Book of Jude says. I think that's where it's at. When we think about that tonight, us that endure to the end, that word saved is, I don't believe, is dealing with salvation there, but we won't be tired anymore. We'll be resting in the arms of God. I'm grateful for that tonight. All right, I'm done. Any questions, comments, concerns?